Hi, my name is Dr. DJ Heusler, and this is our module on eyelid disease. So in this module, we're going to cover anatomy, entropion, distichiasis, ectopic cilia, trichiasis, eyelid agenesis, eyelid tumors, and blepharitis. So the eyelid is composed of modified skin. It's composed of an epidermis and dermis. Most domestic species, this area is a haired structure, has a muscular layer, such as the orbicularis oculi, and the function of the orbicularis oculi is to close the eyelids. There's a muscle called the levator palpebra superioris, and this opens the eyelids. The tarsal layer is composed of meibomian glands, and these are modified sebaceous glands, as well as glands of Mall, which are modified sweat glands. There's a tarsal plate, as well as conjunctiva, and within the conjunctiva are vessels, nerves, and lymphatics. So here are two pictures, one picture of gross anatomy of the eyelid margin and the other histologically of the eyelid margin, showing those structures that we just talked about. So what are the functions of the eyelid? The eyelid protects the globe. They have a palpebral reflex. They remove surface debris from the cornea. It contributes to the tear film with meibomian glands, which secrete the lipid layer. And then blinking distributes the tear film across the corneal surface. The eyelids also regulate light entering the globe. They can restrict light by squinting, and they can allow more light in by keeping the eyelids open. So as we look at some clinical cases as to what you would see in your practice, one common thing that you'll see is entropion. Entropion is an inward rolling of the eyelid. It is highly breed associated in dogs. It's usually secondary to excessive eyelid length and prominent facial folds. We see this commonly in some of the bigger dogs, such as Mastiffs, St. Bernards. We see it in Labradors quite a bit, as well as Golden Retrievers. We also see this in cats. We'll see it in cats that are intact males that'll have the stud jowls. We'll see it in older cats. Older cats will develop a secondary entropion because they have retrobulbar fat atrophy. And so as that fat atrophies, the eyelid will sink a little bit further back into the orbit, which allows the lower eyelid to roll inward. And then we see cicatricial entropion, which is scarring of the eyelid margin. The lower and lateral medial eyelids of the dogs is the most common location to see entropion. Upper eyelids are less common, but we do see this in Shar Pei's, Chow Chows. I'll see it in Golden Retrievers as they get older. And then we see upper eyelid entropion from cicatrix, which is scarring from previous infection, previous surgery, or trauma. So here we have two different pictures of entropion, and this is the most common location, the lower lateral aspect. And what you can do is you'll see these hairs that are contacting the cornea. You can use your thumb to pull on the skin. You'll see it roll back out and then lay flat. And that's the easiest way to diagnose entropion. With entropion, surgical therapy is indicated for resolution. How this is performed is typically we perform a lateral canthoplasty in order to shorten the eyelid margin just a little bit, and then perform a modified Hoechst celsus on the lower eyelid, removing an elliptical piece of tissue in order to allow that eyelid margin to sit flat. Typically, we use 6-0 Surgipro or 6-0 Proline in interrupted sutures in order to tie that Hoechst celsus correctly. Prior to surgery, it's recommended that the patient receive lubrication with hyaluronic acid. This improves patient comfort. It reduces risk for corneal ulceration. And I typically will continue that for 2 weeks after surgery so that the stitches do not cause any corneal ulceration. Distichiasis are hairs that are arising from the eyelid margin. And often these arise from the meibomian gland openings. And they can be single or they can be multiple tufts of hair. The sequela to distichiasis is that they cause epiphora, mucus discharge. They can cause corneal ulceration and squinting, but by far and away the most common complaint is epiphora. So we'll have excessive tearing on the face. And in this picture, you can see that there are multiple distichia that are coming from the meibomian glands and then rubbing on the cornea. For distichiasis, surgical therapy involves follicular cryoablation. It's a freezing of the eyelid margin in order to kill the hair follicle and prevent regrowth. If they are continuously epilated, they will continue to regrow over time, and you'll continue to see these patients in order to epilate the hairs. Short-term medical therapy involves using topical lubrication gel in order to prevent ulceration and irritation to the corneal surface. Cases are typically referred to your local ophthalmologist for cryoablation surgery, as it does take a specific machinery in order to perform the cryoablation. Other abnormal hairs that we'll see that cause problems with the eyes is ectopic cilia. Ectopic cilia are hairs that are emerging through the palpebral conjunctiva, and they cause direct corneal contact. These are incredibly irritating to the patient, as they're like having a small needle underneath the eyelid that is irritating on the cornea. These hairs are typically at the 12 o'clock position, and they do require magnification in order to see them. They are usually pigmented hairs, although sometimes you can have blonde hair or non-colored hairs, which are very difficult to find. But they do require quite a bit of magnification to try to find them. But if you have a dog that's less than 2 years of age and has an ulcer at about the 12 o'clock position and they're very painful, then you can be pretty sure that there's an ectopic cilia involved. With ectopic cilia, the sequelae is that there's marked discomfort and blepharospasm. These patients are excruciatingly painful when they come into your clinic. There's typically corneal ulceration with associated keratitis. Prior to surgery, treat with a topical lubrication gel with hyaluronic acid in order to lubricate the cornea and provide some relief from this hair that's really irritating them. Utilize antibiotics if there's a concurrent corneal ulceration. Typically, ofloxacin or triple antibiotic is sufficient for these patients. Surgical excision of the follicle with cryoablation is the treatment of choice. So typically what we will do is put these patients under a surgical microscope. We'll isolate that ectopic cilia and we'll remove it surgically with a surgical blade. We then provide cryoablation on top of that in order to kill the hair follicle and prevent regrowth. Trichiasis is another abnormality we see with hairs as it relates to the cornea and the eye. Trichiasis are normal hairs that are misdirected and contact the conjunctiva and the cornea. Common locations we see these with is nasal folds in brachycephalics. This is also a component of macropalpebral fissure syndrome. We also see them in the caruncle, and then we'll also see them at the upper lateral eyelid. Sequelae to trichiasis are irritation, blepharospasm, epiphora, and mucus discharge. You'll also see corneal ulceration, especially if it's a component of entropion. So if you have a case with entropion and that eyelid is rolling inward, then those hairs that from the eyelid margin that are contacting the cornea would be considered to be trichiasis. So with treatment for trichiasis, there are surgical therapies, which is nasal fold removal or a medial canthoplasty or a modified Hotzelsis in order to roll the eyelid upward and remove those hairs from touching the cornea. Or there's a blepharoplasty procedure if you can remove a portion of the eyelid in order to eliminate trichiasis. There's medical therapy, such as using topical lubrication with the hyaluronic acid in order to maintain some short-term comfort. And then you want to use antibiotics if there's concurrent corneal ulceration. So on this first photo here, you can see that there is nasal fold trichiasis, and this is on a Pekingese patient where this nasal fold and these hairs are pointing directly at the cornea and causing corneal ulceration. On this second photo here, this is medial coruncular trichiasis, and we see these hairs that are located down in the medial canthus, and those hairs wick fluid onto the face. They can also cause corneal irritation and corneal ulceration. A surgical therapy in this case would be a medial canthoplasty. Eyelid agenesis is a congenital abnormality that we see in cats. That's also an eyelid abnormality. It is an underdeveloped eyelid margin, and it's either partial or complete. Again, most commonly seen in felines. The sequelae are exposure keratitis, trichiasis, and corneal ulceration. There's various treatments that have been reported. Cryotherapy has been utilized to eliminate these hairs. Reconstructive blepharoplasties is a procedure known as a lip-to-lid, where we actually take a portion of the outer commissure of the lip and rotate that graft up to create the lateral acanthus on the cat. And then there's a newer procedure that's called a switch flap, which involves swinging a portion of the lower lid to the upper eyelid in order to recreate an eyelid margin. As we move towards inflammatory diseases, the first one that comes to mind is blepharitis. Blepharitis is inflammation of the eyelids. This can be generalized, diffuse, or local. It's solely with the eyelids or a component of a larger disease process, such as autoimmune skin disorders. There are varying degrees of inflammation, ulceration, alopecia, and pruritus. Etiologies can include bacterial blepharitis, immune-mediated blepharitis, parasitic or mycotic blepharitis, pharmacologic blepharitis, especially seen in cats, viral, such as cats with feline herpes virus, and then traumatic blepharitis. With immune-mediated blepharitis, as a primary immune-mediated blepharitis, we see this as marginal blepharitis. And this involves the eyelids only and mostly the meibomian glands. These are a hypersensitivity to normal meibomian secretions and flora. And these are typical pictures that you will see with immune-mediated blepharitis. The outer eyelid margin is very swollen in these pictures and inflamed, and these can even scab and cause ulceration to the skin surface. Secondary immune-mediated blepharitis is a component of immune-mediated skin disease. We see these in cases of pemphigus, such as vulgaris or foliaceus, as well as discoid lupus and uveodermatologic syndrome. Mycotic blepharitis occurs with Microsporum canis, trichophyton, and rarely blastomycosis. The generalized condition in young immunocompromised patients. We see alopecia and erythema, and a trichogram can be useful in the diagnosis of these patients. We also see parasitic blepharitis, which can be secondary to Demodex or Sarcoptes, generalized condition in young and immunocompromised patients. See alopecia, erythema, and pruritus, and a skin scraping is useful in diagnosis of parasitic blepharitis. We also see viral blepharitis. This is most common in cats with feline herpes virus that will develop a blepharoconjunctivitis. Here we have two pictures of parasitic blepharitis, both caused by Demodex. Pyogranulomatous blepharitis is distinct granulomas centered over meibomian glands. The etiology is not clearly understood. There's a rupture of meibomian glands, it's autoimmune, folliculitis, and there's thought to be a bacterial component as well with these cases. Common sequelae to blepharitis is ulceration, depigmentation, scarring, and necrosis in severe cases. You can also develop a cicatricial entropion and ectropion due to severe cases of blepharitis. As well, keratitis can develop. This is due to exposure and is contiguous with blepharitis. The treatment is aimed at identifying and eliminating the underlying cause. So antimicrobial therapy can be used, which is ideally based on culture and sensitivity results, or scraping or a trichogram. Corticosteroids can be used if it's not mycotic, parasitic, or systemically contraindicated. Biopsy of focal lesions can be obtained in order to get a more definitive diagnosis, and surgical correction of entropion and ectropion can also be very helpful. A chalazion or hordeolum is another abnormality that we see common with eyelids. This is a focal, non-painful swelling of the meibomian gland. There's various etiologies such as meibomian gland dysplasia, neoplasia, or infection. Common sequelae to chalazion are rupture of the chalazion, inflammation of the eyelid, ulceration of the eyelid, and secondary infection. Also develop keratitis and ulceration of the cornea with large masses if they have direct corneal contact. Treatment is aimed at either monitoring if it's incidental or subclinical. You can lance and curettage them as well as by adding cryotherapy to prevent recurrence. Address the neoplasia. You can either excise it directly or perform a debulking with cryoablation. Antimicrobial therapy can be very helpful, and corticosteroids can help as well. Typically not indicated, but can do a topical if there's inflammation and irritation present. So you can take like a triple antibiotic with dexamethasone and put it directly on the eyelid margin. As we move into eyelid neoplasia, In dogs, these are overwhelmingly benign. Greater than 85% of eyelid margins, that eyelid neoplasia that you'll see in your practice, are benign. They're generally in older patients, 10 years of age and older. Common neoplasia that we see is meibomian adenomas and adenocarcinomas, papillomas, melanomas, and then all the rest of them, such as mast cell tumors, histiocytomas, fibromas, etc. In cats, it's quite the opposite. The majority of them are malignant, about 55 to 70%. They're generally older patients as well, greater than 9 years old. Squamous cell carcinoma are the most common, followed by mast cell tumors, hemangiosarcomas, adenocarcinomas, and then more rare ones such as lymphoma, fibrosarcoma, and peripheral nerve sheath tumors.